This is the second post in this series on neural networks. In the first post, we introduced the artificial neuron. We said that each neuron has an activation level. This activation is influenced by three things. One, inputs to the neuron. Two, a set of weights and a bias term. Three, an activation function. In this video, we will take a closer look at activation functions. Activation functions perform two vital roles in neural networks. As we've seen, they play a part in producing the output of a neuron. But as we shall see in parts 4 and 5 of this blog series, they also play a vital role in training a neural network. When a network is trained, adjustments are made to the weights and biases of each neuron. The strength and direction of these nudges or adjustments depend on the activation function. Specifically, it depends upon the first derivative or slope of the activation function. Now, let's not get ahead of ourselves and worry too much about training, adjustments to parameters, and calculus just now. We will come to that later in this series. But for now, when we look at different activation functions and we talk about their derivatives, please do bear in mind that there's a reason for this. The reason is that these derivatives play a vital role in a neural network learning. It learns by making small changes to its weights and biases when presented with training data. Here is our schematic of an artificial neuron with three inputs again. The first step in the calculation of a neuron's output can be thought of as composition. Here we multiply each input by its weight, sum these products, and then add a bias. The result of this composition is then fed into an activation function, the result of which is the neuron's activation or output. And it's this activation that we're interested in this blog post. Activations serve to scale and normalize the outputs. As you'll see, all of the activation functions here are non-linear, i.e. they are not straight lines. This is vital in allowing the network to learn complex non-linear relationships in problems that it is trying to solve. Here is the sigmoid function that we saw in the last post. This squashes and normalizes all the input data from minus infinity to plus infinity into an output range of 0 to 1. As you can see, it also has a simple derivative, which helps a lot in training. Again, more on that in post 4 and 5. In the 1980s and early 1990s, the sigmoid function was the go-to activation function for neural networks, but it does suffer from a fatal flaw. Let me explain. The problem stems from squishing a huge input space, minus infinity to plus infinity, into a tiny output space, 0 to 1. This means that some really big changes in input have only a tiny change in the output. In other words, the derivative is small. Small derivatives will mean only tiny changes to weights and biases in training, and this will slow down the rate of learning in the network. Now, back in the 1980s, this frankly wasn't much of a problem. Most neural networks were quite small, with only a few neurons and a small number of layers. But as networks grew bigger, you started having small gradients multiplied by other small gradients in training. This starts to give you vanishingly small adjustments, and training grinds to a halt. You'll see this referred to in the literature as the vanishing gradients problem. So while it's true that sigmoid functions do have their uses, don't confine them to the scrap heap yet. They're not the ubiquitous workhorses that they once were. But if you want a value between 0 and 1, maybe for models that are predicting a probability where likelihood only exists in a range between 0% and 100%, they might be a good choice. An improvement on sigmoid from a squishing perspective is the hyperbolic tangent. This had its heyday through the late 1990s and early 2000s as a common choice of function. Inputs here are compressed down to the minus 1 to plus 1 range, So the vanishing gradients problem is still there, but it's only half as bad. This function also has a well-behaved derivative that is relatively easy to compute. We can extend this a little further with ArcTan. This ticks a lot of the boxes. It's a non-linear function. It provides both positive and negative outputs and compresses its outputs into a range between minus 1.57 and plus 1.57. Frankly, it's not used that much. We're chasing down a vanishing gradients black hole here. As neural networks get bigger, these types of activation functions become more problematic. And with the successes of neural networks as a solution, coupled with advances in computing power and GPUs to allow truly huge neural networks, these types of activation functions are not so common nowadays. But they do have their uses in certain niches, especially in smaller scale systems. Let's instead turn our attention to what are undeniably the most common activation functions in use today. The place to start is ReLU, or rectified linear unit. This is a simple function that returns zero if the input is less than zero, and then for inputs greater than zero, it simply returns the input. Very straightforward. The derivative is easy to compute as well. It's either one or zero. It's one if the input is greater than zero, and zero otherwise. This very simple derivative really speeds up training. These factors have made this type of activation function the most popular for large-scale networks and computer vision tasks in particular. Given that the gradient for negative inputs is zero, there's still a potential problem. You may hear the term dying ReLUs or dead ReLUs, where training and updating of the weights stalls. If this does become an issue, many people turn to some pragmatic solutions. One is to adopt a leaky ReLU, where values below zero are multiplied by a tiny constant. The default for leaky ReLU is 0.01, but feel free to try out other values. There are many other alternative ReLUs, with ELU, or exponential linear unit, being shown on the screen. Here there's more computation involved in calculating the output as well as the derivative. For small networks, this will not be a problem, but for networks with millions or tens of millions of neurons, additional training time will be noticeable. This has been an introduction to activation functions. The goal has been to get across concepts rather than this be an exhaustive list or catalogue of available options. Do understand what an activation function does. Do understand that calculating its derivative is important in training, to be covered later. And understand that as with much of AI, there is a great deal of room for trial and experimentation with different approaches. When training neural networks initially, it's perhaps best to start with ReLU or hyperbolic tangent, but do be on the lookout for areas where you might profit from some of the dozens of alternatives. In the next post, we'll look at linking neurons together in layers, input layers, output layers, and hidden layers. After that, we'll get into how we train and optimize these networks.